Welcome to Link G4x Training Part 18. In this video, we're going to be taking a look at our closed loop lambda control. Our closed loop lambda control looks at the wideband or the lambda sensor that we fit it to our G4x system. We always want to have some kind of a wideband so that we can see what the air fuel or lambda is doing as we're doing our calibration process. Now, we can take this a step further and utilize that signal or that wideband reading and compare it against a target air fuel table. And we can let the Link G4x system figure out what the difference is. So if we're off from the air fuel that we'd like to be at a load and engine RPM, it can make adjustments to the injector pulse width knowing the difference and being able to hit that desired or target air fuel that we've set. So essentially we're running it in this closed loop operation where the injector pulse width, it's calculated from our main table. And then the closed loop feature is gonna be altering that injector pulse width, either increasing or decreasing it to increase or decrease the fuel so that we hit the target air fuel that we're trying to program. We can utilize this so that the air fuel is consistent day to day and year to year. We can set our closed loop lambda control up so it's gonna be applying to part throttle, to idle, and to wide open throttle. There's different kinds of modes that we can program within the closed loop lambda control. There's gonna be a lot of things to cover. Let's jump into this video so we can check all this out. Okay, so let's get started. We're gonna be taking a look at working with our closed loop fuel correction within our PC Link software. Our closed loop fuel correction is going to be taking a look at an oxygen sensor input into our Link software. It's going to be taking a look at what the reading is going to be, the actual air fuel reading, comparing it to our desired or target air fuel reading, and then it can figure out what the difference is going to be. It can then alter the injector pulse width that's being calculated from our main fuel table and being able to then hit the desired air fuel that we're after. So the closed loop correction is going to be something we definitely want to implement into our tuning routine and even into our operation with our Link system. It's relatively easy to set up. It can guide us in the tuning process or just make minor changes day to day, year to year, seasonal changes. It ensures that the fuel mixture is always going to be dead consistent. Let's actually go here from our basics page and move across into our closed loop fuel page. This is where we set up all the configuration details so the closed loop correction is going to work right. Let's actually go here before we move into talking about any of the programming here. We need to go through some of the fundamentals. Let's actually go into ECU settings here. We're going to go under fuel and then under fuel table. We'll bring our fuel table up on screen right now so we can talk about this really quickly. So whether we're going to be in traditional or modeled mode, we're going to find that the main fuel table represents the base injector pulse width that we need to deliver to the fuel injector. And we're going to be assuming that if we do our calibration process right, if we've tuned these values, we've moved them around till we've gotten the proper air fuel delivered to our engine, that the main table's tuned. The problem's going to be if we start to operate our engine from one season to the next, our intake air temp compensation may not be perfect, and we're gonna find that the air fuel is gonna fluctuate. Now, if we don't have closed loop correction, we're gonna find that it's going to have air fuel moving around. It might go from being at 14.7 one day to the next day being at 14.2 air fuel if we're in cruising conditions with the same exact values in the table. So if we program these values, that's gonna be our fixed amount of injector pulse width. That's not going to change unless we change the raw values within the table. So we're assuming the values in the table are not changing, our injector pulse width is gonna be consistently delivered, but the air fuel is fluctuating because we have these conditions that we, again, can't exactly count for, or we haven't set up our fuel trim, our intake air temp fuel trim table properly, or in the situation in the United States, we have different variations of our gas quality. So one station might be ethanol-free, pure petrol fuel, and then another station might be 10% blended ethanol, and the difference is going to be about an 8 or 10% difference in fuel delivery. So we might not change anything within the table. Our desired air fuel is going to be the same. The injector pulse width isn't going to be changing, but we'll find that the air fuel will change because the fuel is actually changing slightly, and that it is going to affect and disrupt how our fuel delivery is going to be coming from our main table. So the closed loop correction will look at, again, an oxygen sensor input from our exhaust stream. It can determine how much oxygen content we're finding in the actual exhaust stream. It can then figure out what the difference is going to be between our target air fuel and the actual air fuel measured from the sensor, and then start to adjust the base injector pulse width that's being calculated from our main table. It can go and increase it by 5, 10, 20%, however we allow the limits here within the closed loop control, and we'll find them more hitting than the actual air fuel that we're after. So it's gonna know what the difference is, correct that difference, and allow us to run there. Now, the problem is going to be we don't want to consistently run our engine with the closed loop correction doing all of the work. We want to make sure that our main table here is going to be properly tuned. We don't want to rely on the closed loop correction as a band-aid for an improperly tuned main fuel table. So part of our job as a tuner and part of the calibration process is always nailing down the values in here so that we're hitting the airfield that we're after, then utilizing the closed loop correction after the fact to be able to keep us at that desired airfield for things that we cannot account for. We can take this a step further in the closed loop control and actually use it to guide us in making the update changes within our main table. I'll talk about that a little bit later towards the end of the video, but for right now, you should understand what is going on here. So the main fuel table is calculating the base injector pulse with delivering the fuel to the engine. The closed loop correction is going to be taking a look at an oxygen sensor input, taking a look at what the actual air fuel measure is going to be from the oxygen sensor, taking a look at our desired air fuel or lambda amount, looking at the differences, then figuring out a percentage change it needs to make to the injector pulse width against whatever is calculated here from our table, and then we'll find that we should hit that target air fuel. Sounds pretty simple. There's a lot of different configuration details we need to be paying attention to here, because setting up the closed loop control will vary based on what kind of sensor type we're working with and what kind of control that we're after. So I can actually just leave my main fuel table open here. We might refer back to it a little bit later in the video. Now let's talk about some of the fundamentals here with the sensor types that we're working with, so we can recognize the different sensors and then how to set them up properly, and then the different controls based around the different sensor types we might find. So we're going to find that we have two different primary types of oxygen sensors: narrowband, wideband. Narrowband sensor is going to be found on most older OEM vehicles. They're going to operate in a very narrow band of registration of our air fuel. In fact, it's always going to be at stoichiometric or 14.7:1 on petrol fuel or 1.0 lambda. We'll find that they operate, coming up on screen here to illustrate this a little bit better, they operate between a 0 to 1 volt scale. And then we'll find, if we're looking, that's our axis on the left, that's our voltage. And we take a look at our bottom axis, that's going to be our air fuel gasoline petrol scale. We're going to find that at a half volt, that's going to be the equivalent of approximately 14.7:1. So when the sensor is registering and reading, it's going to be outputting a voltage. And depending on what the voltage is going to be, our closed loop correction is going to be adjusting against the voltage. In working with our narrowband sensors, we're not going to be working or taking a look at our target air fuel table here. It's actually going to be taking a look at just a voltage target that we're going to be programming. Now the target air fuel will still be part of the calculations if we're in our VE fuel strategy, but in traditional, this is not going to be utilized for any calculations going on. It'll just be taking a look at that voltage target that it's going to try to shoot for. So it's going to be just taking a look at the raw voltage coming in from the signal coming in as we designate it from a narrowband sensor. And then it's going to be trying to hit that target voltage, which is going to be the equivalent of that target air fuel that we're trying to go after. So very simplistic way to do that. Let's actually take a look at setting up our narrowband sensor first. Then we'll talk about our widebands, which is what we want to use. The narrowband is our least desirable choice, but I still want to cover it here, so it's going to be very clear how to work with a narrowband sensor. So if we go into AI and our analog inputs, we're going to go and set up our narrowband sensor within here. Thanks for checking out our teaser clip. If you want to see the rest of this video and more than 500 hours of current EFI training we have to offer, make sure you click right here. If you want to go and check out more teaser clips from this training course, click here. And you don't want to miss any of the videos we're going to be releasing on this channel, so make sure you subscribe and click here. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys later.